বার্তা সময়ের সাথে মানুষের পাশে।
শ্রী রামনাথ কোবিন্দ, অনারেবল প্রেসিডেন্ট অফ ইন্ডিয়া, শ্রীমতী সবিতা কোবিন্দ, অনারেবল ফার্স্ট লেডি অফ ইন্ডিয়া, শ্রী বনওয়ারিলাল পুরোহিত, অনারেবল গভর্নর অফ তামিলনাড়ু, তিরু তঙ্গম তেনারাসু, মিনিস্টার অফ ইন্ডাস্ট্রি তামিলনাড়ু, ডিস্টিংগুইশড গেস্ট, লেডিজ অ্যান্ড জেন্টলম্যান, ইটস এ ম্যাটার অফ সিঙ্গুলার অনার অ্যান্ড গ্রেট প্রাইড ফর দ্য ডিফেন্স সার্ভিসেস স্টাফ কলেজ টু হোস্ট দি অনারেবল প্রেসিডেন্ট অফ ইন্ডিয়া অ্যান্ড দ্য সুপ্রিম কমান্ডার অফ আর্ম ফোর্সেস অ্যান্ড দ্য ফার্স্ট লেডি ইন দ্য সেকো অডিটোরিয়াম উইচ ইজ বিন নেমড আফটার ফ্লাইং অফিসার নির্মলজিৎ সিং সেকো in the 1971 war, who was awarded with a Paramveer Chakra. The sequence of events for the day will be as follows. Lieutenant General M.G.S. Kalo, Ati Vishesh Seva Medal, 8-day camp, Commandant, Defence Services Staff College, would first deliver the welcome address. This would be followed by the felicitation ceremony. Post the felicitation ceremony, we would have four student officers of the current 77th staff course who would be speaking to everybody on relevant contemporary topics. Post the student officers' talk, we would request the Honorable President of India to address the faculty and the student officers gathered here today. This would be followed by the national anthem, which would conclude the event. May I now request Lieutenant General M.J.S. Kalo, Ati Vishesh Seva Medal, 8-day camp, Commandant Defense Services Staff College, to deliver the welcome address.
Shri Ramnath Kovind ji, Honorable President of India and the Supreme Commander of the Armed Forces, Srimati Savita Kovind, Honorable First Lady, Shri Banwarilal Purohit ji, Governor of Tamil Nadu, Thiru Thangam Thenarasa, Minister of Industry, Tamil Nadu, distinguished guests, brother officers, ladies and gentlemen, Jai Hind and a very good morning. At the outset, it's a great privilege for me to welcome the Honorable President of India and our Supreme Commander, the Honorable First Lady and our distinguished guests, to the hallowed presidents of the Defence Services Staff College, the mecca of all uniformed professionals of our armed forces. Sir, you are the sixth Supreme Commander to visit us since our inception. Staff College Wellington was established post-partition in 1948, based on the nucleus which came to India from Quetta, Pakistan. It started off as the Indian Army Staff College, which evolved into the Inter-Services Staff College and later into the Defence Services Staff College. As the three services realized the value of jointmanship and integration due to the lessons being learned on the battlefield all over the world. From the first staff course held in April 1948 for 50 Army officers for 20 weeks to the present, it has been a long journey over the past 73 years. The motto of our college is Yudham Pragya, into war with wisdom. Sir, seated in front of you are 479 specially selected officers of the 77th Staff Course, including 30 international student officers from 19 friendly foreign countries. Some of them are seated in other halls due to COVID protocols. Each one of them has been specially selected through a very arduous selection process based on strict evaluation and a grueling entrance exam. They represent the best amongst their peer group. We at the DCC, at the staff college here, are mandated to hone their immense potential so that they can occupy challenging command and staff assignments in the armed forces. It is the dream of every young officer being commissioned into the armed forces to one day pass through the portals of this college. Less than 15% make the grade. That is, only 1 in 6 makes the cut. The character of war has always been defined by violence and uncertainty, and it has not changed over the years. But the nature of war has. The changes in warfare have primarily been driven by technology changes and tactics, and the pace of change has been phenomenal. From the trench warfare of First World War to maneuver warfare of Second World War to the ongoing network-centric operations today, there has been a revolution in the military affairs. In addition, newer challenges of dealing with non-state actors, terrorism, climate change fallouts, natural disasters, epidemics, cyber threats, space-based operations have forced military planners all over the world to analyze these emerging threats and incorporate them into our military strategy. The lessons being learned in different hotspots of the world, like Afghanistan, Syria, Libya, Armenia, Azerbaijan, in the Indo-Pacific region, and closer home on the LAC and LOC, are continuously incorporated into what we teach here. The student officers here are also made to understand the impact of geostrategic changes happening in our neighborhood. We also focus upon the adoption and understanding of cutting-edge technologies in all aspects of warfighting in the land, air, and maritime domains. We lay great impetus in imparting critical skills and analytical skills. Ingenuity and innovativeness at the tactical level is greatly encouraged, and we work closely with the three war colleges of the Army, Navy, and the Air Force on these issues. The teaching staff here is carefully chosen, and the directing staff from three services, and we use the domain experts from academia, industry, and the service headquarters to impart instructions. The directing staff also here act as role models and mentors for the student officers. In addition, we at the Staff College train 140 officers of three services in tactical and staff duties undergoing training at the Military Institute of Technology, Girinagar, Pune, where these officers are undergoing a year-long technical staff course. We are also providing some institutional training support to the training institutes of Uzbekistan, Iran, Kazakhstan, and our training teams in Uganda and Tanzania. We have successfully navigated the COVID crisis by graduating onto a hybrid method of learning and teaching. A large number of in-house applications have been developed for the purpose. At the end of the 10 months course out here, the student officers graduate with an MSc degree in Defence and Strategic Studies from the University of Madras. As you are all aware, a large number of changes are afoot in our armed forces post the creation of the post of the CDS and the Department of Military Affairs. A large number of our alumni are actively involved in driving these changes. Our over 20,000 plus alumni have done us proud both in India and abroad in peace and war. We have the distinction of the first Chief of Defence Staff, General Rawat, and 41 ex-chiefs of Army, Air Force and Navy being our graduates. Amongst the 1,800 plus international alumni, we have the distinction of four of them going on to become the heads of state in their respective countries, Nigeria, Fiji, Ghana, and Sri Lanka. His Excellency, the President of Nigeria, currently is Mr. Muhammad Buhari, is a graduate of the 29th Staff Course. His Excellency, the President of Sri Lanka, Mr. Gotabaya Rajapaksha, is a graduate of the 39th Staff Course. In addition, the serving CDS of Maldives and the Chief of Air Staff of Nigeria are also Staff College graduates. In the end, sir, I would just like to thank you once again for taking the time out from your busy schedule to grace us with this visit. Your visit here will spur us on to better our own exacting standards. The Indian Armed Forces have always delivered and shall always prevail on land, air and the high seas. The sacred faith reposed onto us by our countrymen will always be upheld, and the Taranga will always fly high. Jai Hind, sir.
Thank you, sir. It's a unique privilege for the Defence Services Staff College, and in particular the 77th Staff Course, to host the Honourable President of India and the First Lady. We are indeed gratified by your presence, sir. I now request Lieutenant General M.J. Scarlow, Commandant Defence Services Staff College, to present a memento to the Honourable President of India. I now request Mrs. Manmeet Kalo to come up on stage and present a gift to the First Lady, Srimati Savita Kovind. I now request the Commandant, Defence Services Staff College, to present a memento to Sri Banwarilal Purohit, Honourable Governor of Tamil Nadu. Now request the Commandant to present a memento to Thiru Thangara, Minister of Industry, Tamil Nadu. Thank you, sir. We at the Defence Services Staff College lay great emphasis on critical thinking, analysing complex problems and producing workable solutions. To that effect, it is important that the officers undergoing the staff course have a deeper understanding of the complex issues being faced by our country. We utilise the great diversity that we have in this audience here and the knowledge that we have amongst ourselves to promote peer learning. To share their views on contemporary topics, we shall now have one student officer each from the Army, Navy and the Air Force and one international officer of the 77th Staff Course expressing their views on contemporary relevant topics. The first speaker is Major Abhinav Srivastava.
Honourable President of India and the Supreme Commander of the Indian Armed Forces, Sri Ramnath Kovind, ladies and gentlemen, I am Major Abhinav Bhardwaj of the Indian Army. A second generation Army officer, I was raised with values that have instilled in me a deep sense of discipline, pride for the organisation and a respect for the cultural diversity of this great nation. Having served for more than 10 years as a communication specialist, it is my privilege today to stand in front of this august gathering to speak on the subject, Contribution of the Indian Armed Forces towards National Security. With the primary role of defending the sovereignty and territorial integrity of the nation, strong and well-trained armed forces are a deterrent to any potential adversary, thereby facilitating developmental activities and nation-building without any hindrance. National security in the contemporary context goes beyond the narrower confines of internal security and external defense. Since independence, our country has faced its fair share of challenges and has dealt with them with maturity and elan. The armed forces have proved their effectiveness whenever called upon to carry out any mission in furtherance of national interests. By virtue of their role and charter, the armed forces are always at it, be it a peacetime scenario, an internal security situation, or full-scale conflict. As imposers of national will, they have faced challenges ranging from terrorism to insurgency, piracy to providing relief to persons affected by natural calamities, to control internal security situations when they have gone beyond the means of the civil administration. In doing so, the armed forces have always acted without fear or favour and have employed the least possible force required to accomplish their task. Whenever threatened by an external aggressor, our Indian military has always met its mission objectives. I must make a mention of the armed forces' stellar role in the 1971 Indo-Pakistan War, of which we are celebrating the Golden Jubilee this year. This conflict, ladies and gentlemen, had strategic outcomes, to include paving the way for the birth of a new nation-state, Bangladesh. Apart from conventional conflicts, the Indian military's grit and tenacity has been evident in the border skirmishes with both its adversaries. The prolonged deployment in the highest battlefield of the world, Siachen, and Operation Vijay, where regulars and irregulars of the Pakistani army were pushed back from the icy heights of Kargil, are cases in point. Their courage, backed by a strong political will, was also on display in the befitting reply given to the Chinese during their incursions in eastern Ladakh and Galwan. These outcomes have clearly shown that the Indian Armed Forces are alert and determined to protect India's relevance in the geostrategic equation of the region. The Armed Forces have fought and continue to fight full-fledged insurgencies and terrorism in many states. Faced with a higher level of violence, they have been instrumental in controlling the influence of inimical elements and their anti-national motives in the Union Territory of Jammu and Kashmir and the Northeast, as also in assisting the civil administration in fighting Naxalism in selected areas. This has kept the external influence to such insurgencies under check. With multifarious challenges emanating from our immediate neighborhood, the armed forces as security partners have instilled confidence by their actions in support of the foreign policy of the country. We have projected military power in Sri Lanka and Maldives when requested by these governments, and have also contributed to global security by fielding contingents in the United Nations peacekeeping operations. The armed forces also play a pivotal role in assisting own as well as neighboring governments in dealing with natural calamities. The commendable role played by the Indian Air Force during the Nepal earthquake of 2015, the Navy's role in disaster relief operations in the aftermath of Cyclone Tauktae, and the Indian Army's assistance to the civil administration during floods in Kashmir are all examples of meaningful contributions by the Indian Army in these trying times. With the changing world order and the changing nature of conflict, the armed forces are seized of the requirement of being agile and nimble, and have displayed alacrity in harnessing the upcoming and emerging trends in the field of war fighting. The Indian Army is focusing on state-of-the-art technologies like electronic warfare, artificial intelligence, and drones. The Indian Air Force is procuring multi-role platforms, and the Navy is making headways in the fields of indigenization and its blue water capabilities. The armed forces are thus constantly reinventing themselves and progressing towards a multi-domain capability to operate in conventional as well as subconventional environments, keeping in mind the likely future threats of energy, water, and climate security. In conclusion, ladies and gentlemen, the citizens of this great nation look up to the armed forces as proactive, secular, and impartial. This standing and credibility has been established and sustained by dedication, sacrifice, professional competence, and operational effectiveness. We draw strength and inspiration from this and will strive relentlessly to ensure that our national security remains inviolable. Today in this hall are the future thought leaders of the armed forces. We feel privileged to be part of this esteemed institution and to be trained both intellectually and operationally in the art of warfare. The impetus provided here would ensure that we zealously uphold our standing as a people's army of the largest democracy in the world. Thank you, and Jai Hind.
The second speaker is Commander Saurav Banerjee.
The Honorable President of India and the Supreme Commander of the Indian Armed Forces. Ladies and gentlemen, very good morning. I am Commander Saurav Banerjee from the Indian Navy. A specialist in missiles and gunnery, I have served as weapons officer on board frontline warships and have commanded a naval missile boat and a Coast Guard patrol ship. Today, it is my great privilege to speak to you on one of the diplomatic initiatives of our nation. Blue economy, maritime security, regional cooperation, first responder. These are some of the terms which have become synonymous to Indian foreign policy and national leadership. Nearly 6 years ago, standing on the shores of the Indian Ocean in Mauritius, our Honorable Prime Minister Shri Narendra Modi laid out India's vision for the region, Sagar, or security and growth for all in the region. Significantly, the occasion was the commissioning of the Indian-built offshore patrol vessel Barracuda in the service of the National Coast Guard of Mauritius. Therefore, it was natural that Sagar would become the guiding beacon of the diplomatic initiatives of the Indian Armed Forces. The Indian Navy in particular, which calls the Sagar its home, Sagar, meaning ocean in Hindi, has committed itself to the realization of this vision. What is Sagar? It is India's statement of intent towards enhancing maritime security, capacity building, and economic growth among the countries of the Indian Ocean region, thus promoting free trade and eliminating piracy, drug, and human trafficking. Maximizing human security is at the heart of Sagar. Therefore, building the collective competence and interoperability in the region towards addressing non-traditional threats have been the key focus areas of the Indian military diplomatic initiatives. To guide these actions, the Indian Navy has adopted a well-articulated strategy of shaping a favorable and positive maritime environment. Actions taken in accordance with the strategy aim for the legitimate and sustainable use of all maritime resources in the region. Multilateral constructs such as the Indian Ocean Naval Symposium, Indian Ocean Rim Association, the ASEAN Defence Ministers Meeting Plus, and the Goa Maritime Conclave have also been progressing efforts in this direction. The Indian Navy has committed itself for being the preferred security partner for all friendly maritime nations in the Indian Ocean region. From being the first responder in natural disasters in Mozambique and Madagascar, to providing aid during the COVID pandemic to the countries across the oceans and continents, the Indian Armed Forces have delivered remarkable results in humanitarian aid and disaster relief roles. Number of missions undertaken by the Navy for Operation Samudra Setu have only instilled further confidence in the Indian diaspora of the region. Sir, I would like to highlight that most naval officers sitting in the audience today have been a part of these diplomatic missions. It is well known that the armed forces have adopted indigenization and self-reliance as the two pillars of its growth since the 1960s. The Indian Navy has played a pioneering role in the Atmanirbhar Bharat initiative, and more on this subject will be covered by my colleague from the Indian Air Force. In addition, the military training undertaken by the Indian Armed Forces at almost all levels is recognized worldwide for its professionalism. International officers sitting in the audience today, who are among the very best of their own services, are a testimony to this fact. The Navy has even undertaken training in niche domains like submarine operations and naval aviation, which have been deeply appreciated by our regional partners. The guiding principles of Sagar enable India's diplomatic efforts, both military and otherwise, to remain rooted in our civilizational ethos of selflessness and striving for the collective good. Our forefathers had a vision that we continue to espouse today, Vasudev Kutumbakam, or the world is one family. However, there are forces in this region who do not subscribe to our vision. Some nations dream of a national rejuvenation built on unfair exploitation of resources and unfounded claims to the vast swaths of the high seas. Such policies are posing a real challenge to the maritime harmony, sovereignty, and autonomy of especially the smaller nations. India has accordingly stepped up and proactively sought to address these ill-intentioned moves. Through a series of bilateral, trilateral, and multilateral initiatives, we have asserted our intent to protect the global commons from such forces. International groupings like the Quad or the Quadrilateral Security Dialogue, trilateral associations like the India, UAE, France, and the Australia, Japan, India, and multilateral associations like the BIMSTEC have provided the platform through which we have restated our commitment to a free and open Indo-Pacific. Ladies and gentlemen, notwithstanding this uncertain and dynamic times, rivalries and competition in international relations, the future of our region looks promising. with the increasing number of diplomatic constructs, joint military exercises, and regional cooperation, India's national vision of Sagar is poised to succeed and sustain beyond the immediate future. You would all agree that the armed forces are the instruments of foreign policy. Peace and security is essential for the entire global community. Hence, the armed forces have dedicated themselves to establish this condition of harmony in our areas of interest. Naval ships, submarines, and aircraft remain ever ready to deter any threats, even as we continue working with our friends and partners across the region. Sir, to conclude, I would like to reiterate that such noble diplomatic initiative is bound to flourish and evolve so as to ensure safety, security, and growth in the Hind Mahasagar or the Indian Ocean. Thank you. Shanavarana, Jai Hind.
The next speaker is Wing Commander Vinamrata Sharma.
Honorable President of India, the Supreme Commander of Indian Armed Forces, ladies and gentlemen, I'm Wing Commander Vinamrata Sharma, the youngest Cat A air traffic controller from the Indian Air Force. Being the sole women officer from the 77th Staff Corps, it's a matter of pride and great honor for me to be speaking on a topic which is close to my heart and forms the backbone of my belief system, Atmanirbharta or self-reliance. India is the fourth largest military in the world, and ironically also the second largest importer of arms. Until recently, we relied heavily on various countries for weapons, spares, and niche technologies. Amidst the existing legacy challenges in the neighborhood, the non-availability of spares on vintage platforms and sensors creates vulnerabilities. The Atmanirbhar Bharat campaign, ushered in by our Prime Minister, would prove to be a game changer in restructuring India's defense capabilities and would lead the entire nation on the path of self-reliance. His vision for self-reliance in defense is the single most important constituent of strategic independence and was unveiled in May last year. The Atmanirbhar program envisions an annual turnover of 1.75 lakh crore by 2025. Towards this, the government has pushed for self-reliance by not only streamlining the defense procurement, but also by announcing a number of key initiatives like implementation of negative import list, setting up of dedicated defense industrial corridors and parks, modernization of major shipyards and ordnance factories, project management units and innovation ecosystem to encourage micro, small, and medium enterprises and other private players. One can easily say that Make in India, especially in defense production, will now be the pivot for change and the guiding beacon for India's quest to be a regional military power. Armed forces have always led from the front and would aim to be the torchbearers of Atmanirbhar campaign. All three services now have independent structures at the apex level dedicated to indigenization in defense production. Indian Navy is the lead service in indigenization for over three decades and is ready to offer a befitting tribute to 75 years of India's independence by commissioning country's first indigenous aircraft carrier in 2022. Another major development is the recent proposal for building three nuclear attack submarines with 95% Make in India content. Being the largest of all three arms, Indian Army is all set to modernize its air defense guns, besides induction of Arjun main battle tank, light utility helicopters, and countermeasure systems for armored fighting vehicles. Indian Air Force is perhaps the most sensitive to technological changes, and Atmanirbharta has shown potential with the induction of light combat helicopter, Astra air-to-air missile, and potent medium-range SAM systems. To touch the sky with glory of self-reliance, Indian Air Force is already in the process of receiving Tejas aircraft. The latest deal involves participation for more than 500 companies and is India's largest ever indigenous defense deal. Change is never easy, but inevitable, and so is the path of Atmanirbharta. There are challenges facing defense industry in its pursuit of self-reliance. The leadership of the country has identified these challenges correctly. A closer look at the defense acquisition policy and the export promotion policy 2020 demonstrates the government's resolve to synergize procurement, research and development, and defense production to create a sustainable and viable defense industry. To add to it, the negative import list is expected to garner orders worth 4 lakh crore within the next 7 years. Statistics reveal that India's population is amongst the youngest in the world. It's about time that the potential of these young and innovative minds is tapped to help see the unseen, to invent out-of-box solutions. Smart initiatives like the Dare to Dream and the IDEX serve as the right platform for doing the same. An evolving ecosystem with a number of startups, R&D institutes and academia will provide the much-needed booster shot for increasing India's defense capabilities. Achieving Atmanirbharta, or self-reliance in defense, is a journey, not a destination. I'm sure that you all will agree that scope for self-reliance is only limited by our own vision. A capable nation seeks strength from the number of combat platforms and weapons. The way forward is to transform ourselves from a buyer's nation into a maker's nation, become Atmanirbhar. India's self-reliance on defense capabilities will boost her standing of being a preferred security partner in Indian Ocean region. The industry is already exporting defense equipment to 84 countries. And the performance has been spectacular, having grown 15 times in the past 6 years. We are at the cusp of a golden dawn in indigenous defense capability. What could be better than leaving you all with a quote from the missile man of India, late Dr. APJ Abdul Kalam, who, sir, like you, was a supreme commander and a visionary. "You have to dream before your dreams can come true," unquote. May our dreams come true. Jai Hind.
The last officer speaking today is Commander S.M. Abdullah Voits.
Honorable President of India and Supreme Commander of the Indian Armed Forces, distinguished ladies and gentlemen, very good morning, in fact. I'm Commander Voits from Bangladesh Navy. I was commissioned in 2004, and I'm a specialist in navigation and direction. My specialist tenures were on board frigates and corvettes of Bangladesh Navy, and I have commanded one patrol craft and a missile boat. I have sailed extensively in the Bay of Bengal, South China Sea, and East Mediterranean during my service. I have also served in the United Nations Peacekeeping Mission in Enifil, Lebanon, from 2014 till 2015. Today, I feel extremely privileged to stand before you to speak on a topic of immense contemporary relevance. The Indo-Pacific region and the ongoing great power rivalry therein is a matter of intense discussion around the world. Today, I shall highlight how this rivalry affects the countries of this region, and also I shall offer some ideas on how countries can work together to address these concerns. Now, geographically, Indo-Pacific is the convergence of the Pacific and Indian Ocean, which interconnect in Southeast Asia. In recent times, countries of this region have witnessed remarkable economic growth and enhanced military capabilities. China in particular has grown exponentially as a leading global power and has challenged US influence in this region. This has triggered a great power competition in the Indo-Pacific, where the key actors are the United States and China. Now, surprisingly, Beijing views the Indo-Pacific construct as a US product to contain China's growth. On the other hand, US and its allies have been watchful of China's approach towards the Indo-Pacific. In 2017, during the Asia-Pacific Economic Cooperation Summit, former US President Donald Trump announced the free and open Indo-Pacific vision to deny China those gains which were inconsistent with the international law. Since then, other significant stakeholders in the Indo-Pacific like Australia, India, Indonesia, Japan, South Korea, Vietnam have engaged in cooperative frameworks to secure their collective interests. Unfortunately, the competition has intensified during the ongoing pandemic. At the same time, it has put the smaller nations in a great dilemma, driven largely by the geoeconomic consequence of choosing a side. Now, understandably, Indo-Pacific finds itself in the center of this interplay because of its rapid economic and military growth. Today, China, India, Japan, and South Korea are the leading global economies, while my country, Bangladesh, is one of the fastest growing economies in the world. However, the trade equations are not balanced. By virtue of its manufacturing capacity, China has gained positive debt ratio with almost all the countries in this region. In contrast, US economic involvement in this region is seemingly meager and primarily limited to its partner nations like Australia, India, and Philippines. As China continues with the aggressive military modernization plan, she has become more assertive, particularly in the South and East China Sea. In addition, China's handling of COVID-19, security legislation for Hong Kong, human rights abuses, and aggression in the Indian border have raised doubt about the character of future superpower China. As a result of this rivalry, there are some important issues which might affect the countries of this region. Firstly, the militarization of the Indian Ocean region have intensified, and more extra-regional powers are gathering in this area. This may lead to increased tension and risk in future. Secondly, China's ongoing development project like the Belt and Road Initiative could change the energy and economic landscape of this region. This may lead to a change in shift how countries focus their economic growth in this region. Finally, the infrastructure development by the Chinese funding is of great value to the developing nations in this region. In Bangladesh, for example, China has invested in building road, rail line, and power projects. If this ongoing competition leads to a conflict, these developing nations may face severe challenges. Now, let me share a few ideas on how the international community can work towards mitigating the negative impact of this rivalry. Firstly, countries with economic capacity should offer alternatives to Chinese funding. The initiative like Build Back Better World, launched during the G7 summit this June, seems to be a step in this direction. Its success, however, would require careful implementation and strong political support from all quarters. Secondly, regional players, particularly India, need to play a larger role. The initiative like Asia-Africa Growth Corridor and Indo-Pacific Ocean Initiative need to be supported and enhanced. Projects focused on the regional need to be taken up and executed under regional frameworks. One such example is the Bangladesh, Myanmar, and India's integration and engagement with Asia-Pacific through the Asia-Pacific Economic Corridor, or IPEC, project, which seeks to promote regional stability and economic prosperity. Finally, the multilateral constructs need to be explored to their maximum potential. One such example is the Bay of Bengal Initiative for Multisectoral Technical and Economic Cooperation, or BIMSTEC, which was welcomed by most of the South Asian nations. Such regional cooperation can minimize the potential negative outcomes of economic overdependence on a single nation. In conclusion, it is my recommendation that approaching the Indo-Pacific construct as a China containment policy is not likely to succeed. If the ongoing competition focuses on developing competitive options, it may lead to positive outcomes. Otherwise, there are challenging times ahead for the developing and smaller nation in this region. Ladies and gentlemen, it is the need of the hour that countries come together, work hand in hand to prevent conflict and promote healthy competition, which will allow growth, development, and prosperity for our people. Thank you all for your patience.
Thank you, officers. On behalf of the Commandant Defence Services Staff College, may I now request the Honourable President, Sri Ramnath Kovind, to address the student officers and the faculty members gathered here today.
Governor of Tamil Nadu, Sri Banwarilal Purohit. Minister for Industries, Government of Tamil Nadu, Sri Thangam Thennarasu. Commandant of the Defence Services Staff College, Lieutenant General MJS Kailum. Senior officers and faculty, student officers of the 77th Staff Course, ladies and gentlemen. I am delighted to be here with the bright participations of this course at one of the premier armed forces training institutes of our country. This college has the mandate of imparting training to selected officers of our armed forces and friendly foreign countries. My special greetings to the 30 student officers from other countries who are also attending this course. I am glad to hear insightful speeches from the young student officers on complex issues of strategic significance touching upon internal and external security, Sagar military diplomacy roadmap, self-reliance, and power rivalries in the Indo-Pacific with reference to countries in the Indian Ocean region. I am especially delighted that there was a lady officer among the speakers. I have been told that the number of lady officers in this course is going to rise in the future. That is a welcome development. The natural beauty of the Nilgiri Hills and the salubrious climate of this area are conducive to learning. I am told that the word salubrious is often repeated to describe the climate and weather conditions of this area. Its Latin root words denote its meaning as health-giving. This place is only 11 degrees north of the equator, but it has very pleasant weather throughout the year. In the early 19th century, the first sanitarium of the Madras Presidency was set up in this region. Since then, the health-giving and energizing climate of this region has been utilized for various purposes, including learning by defense professionals like you. Ladies and gentlemen, I am told that the student officers present here have been selected through a rigorous process based on assessment of competence and potential. My compliments to each one of you for earning this opportunity to learn. Armed Forces officers attached with me have been describing their experiences in this course. I find that they talk about it with a lot of enthusiasm. I assume you all are aware of the significant changes instituted in the higher defense organization of the country. Impetus is also being provided to indigenization and self-sufficiency in the defense sector. These initiatives have been taken with a view to make the armed forces future ready. As you go up to the ladder of growth, you will have to graduate from the level of single service competencies to multi-domain challenges. That requires greater understanding of joint and multi-domain operations. As the armed forces work together, greater integration, jointness, and synergy will become stronger. In this context, participation by a few civil service officers and officers of the Coast Guard widens the canvas of mutual learning through this course. Ladies and gentlemen, the armed forces of our country are amongst the most respected entities of our great nation. They have earned the regard of the fellow citizens by untiring efforts and great sacrifices. They have rendered invaluable services to the nation during the times of war and peace. They have discharged their duties with dedication and courage while facing internal and external security challenges and in times of natural calamities. The recent past has been very difficult for the entire humanity. The COVID-19 pandemic has impacted all walks of life. I have been told that Defense Services Staff College has successfully run the scheduled courses by effectively adopting a hybrid system, blending conventional and online learning. I believe significant changes have also been made in the curriculum and the methods of learning to make it more relevant to emerging challenges. I have been told that the curriculum of the course has always been comprehensive and intense. Because of the quality of content and methods, this course is very popular in other countries also. Ladies and gentlemen, I would like to convey my appreciation for the outstanding grit and determination displayed by men and women of the armed forces in dealing with the situation on our borders as well as the COVID-19 pandemic. Very recently, I had an opportunity to interact with our officers and soldiers in the Kashmir Valley. I felt very happy to observe their high morale and dedication to duty. Most of you have been among the frontline warriors dealing with these challenges. The country appreciates your commitment and contribution. We are passing through challenging times, which is full of changes. The concepts of national security and defense are changing. Geostrategic and geopolitical compulsions and many other factors have made the security landscape more complex. Low-intensity conflicts, counter-terrorism, and non-combat conflicts pose different challenges. There is a need to have a thorough understanding of all aspects. In these changing times, we have to think of new ways to secure our national interests and ensure our national security. This would require a fresh approach. I am told that during the staff course, you will be given comprehensive inputs to help you understand the changing dynamics. With an understanding of the larger picture, you will be able to identify your role in the areas of national security. The emerging threats in the cyber world and space require a state-of-the-art technological responses. Use of advanced technology by non-state actors also calls for upgraded response. Issues like climate change may have impact on security preparedness. All such issues influence the security calculus of the nation. You have to comprehend their implications so that you are better prepared to deal with them. Ladies and gentlemen, and dear student officers, every new generation stands on the shoulders of previous generations, builds upon this heritage, and makes new advances. You all have been identified as potential leaders of our armed forces. You have to emulate the extraordinary standards set by your predecessors and go beyond them. The 21st century society is described as knowledge society. Knowledge truly is power in this century. Just as we are said to be in an era of knowledge economy, we are also in the age of knowledge warfare. As defense professionals, you have to be a knowledge warrior. The motto of this college is Yuddham Pragya, which has been translated as into war with wisdom. Let me touch upon the significance of the word Pragya in this context. Sanskrit words cannot have their exact English translations. However, it is possible to comprehend their essence. The word Smriti denotes knowledge about the past. The word Mati describes awareness about the future. The word Buddhi indicates grasp of the present. But the word Pragya covers knowledge about past, present, and the future, all the three dimensions of time. So, Yuddham Pragya is a very meaningful motto. You build upon the experiences of the past, align such learning to the current context, and upgrade your knowledge to become ready for the future. I am sure that your professional learning here at DSSC will enable you to imbibe the required competencies. It will equip you with the right toolkit to take on bigger challenges in the future. In order to become effective leaders of men and women, you will have to demonstrate excellence in personal and professional domains. Confidence, courage, endurance, integrity, humility, and simplicity will strengthen you as a person. Continuous learning of cutting-edge technologies, state-of-the-art strategies and tactics, and latest developments will make you sound professionals. I wish the student officers and distinguished faculty the very best in your joint learning endeavors. Thank you. Jai Hind.
Subscribe korun Jugbarta. Click korun app er bell icon. Amaderke bohu manusher kache pouche dewar jonno like, comment এবং প্রচুর শেয়ার করুন। সঙ্গে থাকুন আমাদের। আমাদের চ্যানেলে আপনার সংস্থার বিজ্ঞাপনের জন্য যোগাযোগ করুন 8391938440 এই নম্বরে।